Driven, the Christian Baron Roderick assumed the throne of Spain, unaware of the new force rising in North Africa. When the commanders of the Muslim armies challenged King Roderick, it proved to be a major turning point in Europe's history. When the Roman Empire collapsed in the 5th century, the Visigoths moved down from eastern Germany into Italy, France, and Spain. Europe had become a chaotic, bloody battleground, ravaged by bands of mercenaries and warring kingdoms. These were called the Dark Ages. Visigoths had settled in Spain with its hot and harsh climate. Over the centuries that followed, they terrorized the peasant farmers who turned to the Christian church for protection.
Such grievous disasters. Even if every limb were transformed, it would be beyond human nature to express.
The story now begins.
It was in the fourth year of the reign of the Emperor Justinian that Walid received the scepter of the Saracens and succeeded his father as ruler of the Arabs.
The new Arab ruler, Walid I, was a follower of Islam, the new religion founded in Arabia by a prosperous merchant named Muhammad. According to the faithful, Muhammad had received the divine word of God in a series of visions delivered by the angel Gabriel.
In the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful, recite in the name of your Lord who created man from clots of blood. Recite, your Lord is the most bountiful one, who by the pen taught man what he did not know.
The words of God were recorded in the Quran. Allah Akbar was their prayer. God is the greatest. There is no God but God, and Muhammad is his messenger. There is only one God. God is the greatest. With astonishing speed, Muhammad's followers created an empire, conquering and converting villages, towns, cities, and whole states throughout the Middle East. While other armies were slow and cumbersome, the Arabs could travel great distances and would strike when least expected. Using traditional tactics of desert warfare, the Arabs overwhelmed all opposition. They would attack swiftly at their enemy's weakest points and then collect food and recruits to reinforce their army for its relentless expansion. The Arab Empire grew rich as the Islamic army spread the new religion. From Mecca and Arabia through the Middle East, into Egypt, and across North Africa. By the beginning of the 8th century, they had reached the edge of Europe and stood poised upon a new era. The Arab ruler Walid appointed Musa ibn Nusayr to be the new governor of North Africa. Musa turned to Spain, where his spies told him that the Visigothic kingdom was in turmoil. Witiza, the Christian king of Spain, who had ruled only 9 years, suddenly died. By tradition, when a king grew old, the Visigoth barons would gather to choose a successor. The Spanish kingdom now faced a dangerous dilemma. The leaders of the church were worried. A new king had to be found. It was at this point, wrote the chronicler, that a Visigothic baron named Roderick
rebelliously seized the kingdom at the instigation of the palace officials and his supporters.
Roderick was a powerful chieftain whose stronghold was the town of Merida in southern Spain. He was confident that he could defeat the other barons and rule the country, and this was his chance. He quickly organized an army and marched to the capital to claim the throne. In the political climate of the time, the church drafted all the laws. Even after seizing the throne, Roderick would not survive without the bishop's blessing at his coronation. The church leaders were anxious for the stability and protection that a strong king could offer. The beginning of a new reign was a very vulnerable time, a time when a king might be challenged and have to prove himself in battle. This was especially true for Roderick. Roderick enjoyed strong backing from his home region in the south, but very few northern barons offered their support. The church decided to back Roderick as the candidate most likely to unite the kingdom of the Visigoths. The coronation was a step into the unknown. No one really knew if Roderick could hold the fragile kingdom together. Even as the traditional crown of the Visigoths was lowered onto Roderick's head, he still faced powerful rivals.
History's turning points will continue on TLC.
From the massacre at Somme to Waterloo, feel the sting of war. Return to the battlefield, Sunday night at 10 on TLC.
This program is brought to you in part by the Braun Oral-B Plaque Remover.
This is no ordinary toothbrush. This is a Braun Oral-B Plaque Remover. The new Braun Oral-B Ultra. Its ultra-speed oscillating brushing action removes plaque better than an ordinary toothbrush. That's not our opinion. That's clinical fact. And its unique cup-shaped brush head cleans even below the gum line. Dentists recommend changing your toothbrush every 3 months. We suggest you change it forever with the Braun Oral-B Ultra.
Announcing the Lexus award-winning sales event. Your opportunity to take advantage of exceptional values whether you buy or lease. And considering that we've also just received new awards from J.D. Power & Associates, you'll see we have ample reason to toot our own horn. In our own way, of course. See your Lexus dealer today for model year-end values.
I whack the weeds. So you want to know what's on my Discover card statement. I'm a camp cook and a bad one, but I've got a good stove. And he loves to chase that. The cash back bonus award.
It all folds up into a carry.
She loves to get flowers, and I love to give them.
How many credit cards make a statement like that?
Well, the toughest thing about buying a wetsuit is trying them on.
It pays to Discover. Use it where you see the Nova sign.
Tomorrow, Real History's Sacred Quest Week continues. Search for the Grail and the mystery behind a holy relic. It could be Christ's burial cloth or the greatest fake in history. The Holy Grail and the Shroud of Turin, tomorrow at 9 on TLC.
History's Turning Points continues on TLC.
Legend has it that Roderick was an impatient man who had no time for tradition.
In the royal city of Toledo stood the House of Wisdom, a locked tower said to contain magic secrets. It is said it was the tradition for Visigoth kings when they ascended the throne that they should add one more lock to the door to give protection to those secrets. Roderick refused to follow this tradition and climbed to the top of the tower. To the horror of his people, Roderick demanded that the door be opened. Alone, he entered that room. Upon the table was a casket inlaid with gold and jewels. Inside, Roderick found a parchment with a terrifying prophecy. When this house and this casket, which has been so wisely locked, shall be opened, then shall the nation shown here enter the land, and the kingdom shall be blotted out. At these words, Roderick wept for what he had done.
Any fears Roderick felt were quickly forgotten when he set out to stop the continuous raids launched by the Basques in northern Spain. Roderick knew that if the Basques were not halted, other regions would break away and his whole kingdom could crumble. He set off for the far north of Spain, unaware that a greater threat to his kingdom lay to the south. Before they could ever conquer Spain, the Arabs first had to consolidate their rule in North Africa. The Berbers were a fiercely independent people, known for their horsemanship and military skill. Once they had lived throughout the region, but the encroaching Arab armies had pushed them back to the security of their mountain strongholds. From here, they could launch swift attacks and ambush the Arabs. In one such attack, they had killed the commander of the Arab forces. It had taken 30 years and many epic battles before the Berbers finally surrendered to Arab rule. Thank you. Once defeated, the Berbers converted to Islam and fought for the Arab Empire. The main Berber leader was Tariq ibn Ziyad, a man thought fearless and deadly like the cobra. His family had been slaves of the Arabs and then later converted to Islam. Tariq was summoned to a meeting with the new Arab governor, Musa ibn Nusayr. Tariq had earned his freedom through loyalty to his Arab masters. Musa was recruiting troops for the raid he was planning on southern Spain. He told Tariq of his plans and ordered him to bring his fighters to the port of Tangier. Twenty miles across the sea lay Spain. Musa was determined to capture its wealth. Tariq would lead the first raiding party to test the resistance of the defending Visigoths. In the year 711, with a force of 700 men, Tariq set sail for Spain. They landed at the foot of a large rock, which is known to this day as Gibraltar, from the Arab Jabal al-Tariq, Tariq's Rock. Tariq and his men met little resistance in the early stages of their invasion. The Visigoths were weakened from fighting among themselves over Roderick's succession to the throne. Tariq went about his task easily, pushing on from Gibraltar and setting out to establish Arab control over the Spanish coastline.
History's turning points will continue on TLC.
Look at that damage.
Where'd I go wrong?
You should have waterproofed. New improved Thompson's Water Seal Waterproofer has more power for more protection. Long-lasting protection. Don't wait till it's too late. Thompson's is protection.
American Express, how can I help you?
Mr. Carter, I have you booked on the next flight to Taipei.
I've got you confirmed on that flight to New York.
If they were American Express traveler's checks, there'll be no problem.
That's no problem.
I'll have your medicine sent to your hotel right away.
Right now, you have just over 2,000 membership rewards points.
Maybe you'd like to speak to one of our financial advisors.
Financial advisors?
Talk to me about where you want to be when you retire.
I reserve 4 seats. Would it be anything else?
Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, American Express helps you do more.
Oh, Fluffy, a bug. Let's call Terminix.
Call 1-800-TERMINIX for any bug problem. Nobody has a better money-back guarantee.
Fluffy, don't call Terminix if you want to see Cat again.
Nobody bugs bugs like Terminix.
Fluffy!
Tomorrow on Science Frontiers, witness the complexity of creation, the particulars of procreation, the miracle of life. The mystery of birth, tomorrow night at 10 on TLC.
Time. There's never enough of it for all the things you need to do, like getting in shape and staying fit. Now with the WalkFit Exerciser from NordicTrack, time is on your side. The safe, non-motorized WalkFit gives you a combined upper and lower body workout. It's all in this free WalkFit video information kit. Yours when you call this toll-free number. In just 20 minutes a day, just 3 days a week, you can discover all the enjoyment and all the benefits of walking and the time-honored quality of NordicTrack, known the world over for unsurpassed reliability. Let our 30-day in-home trial convince you that WalkFit is the fun way to look great and feel like you're turning back the clock. Call this number now for your free WalkFit video information kit and take the first step to better fitness. WalkFit from NordicTrack, your time machine to total body fitness.
History's Turning Points continues on TLC.
The Arab forces moved inland, past the crumbling Roman ruins, and threatening the rise of a new empire to rule over Spain. It took time for the Visigoths to realize what was happening. When they did, Roderick's supporters sent messengers 600 miles to the north, with the news for their king that an invasion of the south was underway. Told that the Arab raiders numbered a few hundred men, Roderick was confident his royal troops could easily defeat the invaders. Without waiting to raise a larger force, Roderick hastily set off for the south to meet his fate. After an exhausting march to the south, Roderick and his troops arrived at the Guadalquivir River Valley. The Visigoths were used to military tactics where the opposing forces faced each other across the battlefield. But the Berbers were a very different enemy, one that was fresh, mobile, and attacked with lightning speed. Straight for Roderick, because they knew that once the Visigoth king fell, the morale of his troops would collapse and victory would be theirs. The Berbers quickly surrounded the confused and exhausted Visigoths. Tariq looked on as his men won the day. King Roderick was killed. News of Tariq's stunning victory soon reached Musa in North Africa. Spain was now at his mercy. Musa landed a large army in southern Spain, determined to complete the conquest. Meanwhile, Roderick's death left the Visigoths hopelessly divided. Tariq took Cordoba and the royal city of Toledo. Musa captured Seville. Following a string of successes, Tariq and Musa met. Instead of welcoming his Berber commander, Musa deliberately humiliated him in a gesture that demonstrated that Musa was the absolute master. Those remaining of King Roderick's men took refuge in Merida. Soon the Arabs surrounded the town. Visigoths desperately held out for 4 months until they ran out of food and water and were forced to surrender. Musa's retribution was stern. He ordered all the surviving males in Merida to be killed. The women and children became slaves. After seeing what happened at Merida, other Spanish towns quickly submitted to Arab rule, signing the treaties Musa offered.
Those who surrender and submit themselves to the patronage of God and become clients of his prophet will not be killed, enslaved, or separated one from another. They will not be molested in the performance of their religion, nor will their churches be destroyed.
With the Spanish cities paying an annual tax on their citizens and slaves, Musa reaped a rich income both for the Arab Empire and himself.
History's Turning Points will continue on TLC.
Where can you get big savings on the best paint money can buy? At Sherwin-Williams. Save $5 a gallon on Classic 99 interior paint and A100 exterior paint.
Where to get it?
You know, meat's a dog's natural food. And when was the last time you saw a dog grazing in a field?
Dr. John Hamill, veterinarian and top breeder.
Meat's what they love. So that's why I feed mine Pedigree, the number one meat dog food in America. It's 100% complete and balanced, and a great source of quality protein. My dogs love it.
I couldn't see myself feeding my dogs anything else.
Developed with the vets at the Waltham Center. Pedigree, recommended by top breeders.
I've had a computer for a couple of years now, but to be honest, I didn't see what all the fuss was about. Then I got America Online. Now I use it all the time. It makes my life easier. Watch. Use email to send messages to family and friends. Point and click your way around the internet with America Online's great new web browser. And there's more. Scan hundreds of magazines, get sports scores, enjoy hobbies, even shop online. So call this toll-free number and get everything you need to make your life easier and more fun.
Choices!
You gotta make choices.
Hey, kid, you wanna fly? You gotta buy.
No!
Exercise the right choice.
Visit your local park and recreation department today.
Up next, an entire North Carolina settlement vanishes with no explanation. Now experts dig for clues to the lost colonists. Be there to investigate the finds on yet another startling episode of Archaeology. It's only here on TLC.
TLC takes you into the heat of battle. From the massacre at Somme to Waterloo, feel the sting of war. Return to the battlefield, Sunday night at 10 on TLC.
History's Turning Points continues on TLC.
The chronicler recorded that Spain was enslaved and then destroyed by Musa. But Walid, the Arab ruler in Damascus, grew jealous of Musa's wealth and power. After 18 months, he summoned Musa home and demanded to see him. Musa brought Walid gold and silver from Spain, as well as a large quantity of valuable ornaments, precious stones and pearls. Walid belittled Musa, fined him heavily, and sentenced him to death. A desperate Musa handed over his entire fortune to the caliph in exchange for his life. He spent his remaining days in poverty and disgrace. With Musa's fall, Tariq also lost his command. He left Spain and returned to his Berber homeland in North Africa, a defeated man without a future. The Arab conquest of Spain was truly a turning point in European history. During their 700-year rule, the Arabs brought advanced techniques of irrigation and agriculture from the Middle East into Europe. They also brought with them Greek and Arabian manuscripts, which shaped the future of Western mathematics and philosophy. The intellectual awakening that occurred in Europe during the Renaissance resulted in part from Arab achievements in literature, law, music, and history, and their contributions to the sciences of geography and astronomy helped make possible the later voyages to the New World.
Tragic opening chapter in American colonial history, and perhaps a 400-year-old murder mystery. 33 years before the Pilgrims set foot on Plymouth Rock, 100 English men, women, and children struggled to survive on an island in North Carolina, then vanished without a trace. Today, archaeologists and historians still follow the cold trail of the lost colonists, hoping to uncover their ultimate fate.
I'm John Rhys-Davies. Join me as we examine the riddle of Roanoke, next on Archaeology.
August the 18th, 1590. The little island of Roanoke, wedged between the mainland and outer banks of what would become North Carolina, lay ominously silent. 3 years earlier, 100-odd colonists had bidden their governor farewell as he embarked for England for new supplies, promising to return promptly. Stretched his absence into years. As John White came ashore, there were no cries of greeting from his colonists. The settlement was empty. The only clue to the whereabouts of the colonists, carved on a post, was the word Croatoan, the name of a nearby island. Among the missing were John White's daughter and his granddaughter, Virginia Dare, the first English child born in the New World.
White never made it to Croatoan, now called Hatteras Island. But several search parties sent to North Carolina in the following years found no trace of the colonists. Decades later, settlers at Jamestown would hear rumors that they were thriving among the natives elsewhere, or alternatively, that they had been slaughtered. But the final fate of the 100 eludes us. After four centuries, is there any chance that the mystery of the lost colony can still be solved?
On the north end of the quiet, wooded island of Roanoke stands an unimposing earthen fort, the centerpiece of the Fort Raleigh National Historic Site. It was reconstructed in 1950, based on several excavations by legendary Park Service archaeologist J.C. Harrington. Each year, hundreds of visitors come here to relive the tragic story of England's first ill-fated attempts to colonize the New World. For many, it is an unfamiliar tale. Circumstances have conspired to make the first English colony an historical footnote, according to Karen Kupperman, author of The Abandoned Colony.
When history writing became a profession in this country and history publishing, it was centered in New England. And I think a New England version of history basically was created in the 19th century. When I say to people that I work on the earliest colonies, they always say to me, oh, you mean the Pilgrims. Roanoke just doesn't seem to have a place in the national consciousness.
Today, historians and archaeologists are determined that the story of America's first colony should not be forgotten. To restore it to its rightful place in history, they are leaving no stone unturned. Archaeologist Nick Lucchetti directs this season's expedition at Roanoke. Following in the footsteps of so many other excavations, Lucchetti's team must respond to mere shadows of clues. At the main dig site, they carefully bisect circles of dirt that are slightly darker than the surrounding soil, looking for the remains of the long-gone wooden posts of a fort. Technically, the families of the lost colony were not the first colonists at Roanoke. Beginning 2 years earlier, in 1585, about 100 English soldiers had attempted to set up a base on the island called Fort Rawley. The soldiers had been sent by Walter Raleigh, a favorite of Queen Elizabeth. Raleigh had watched the Spanish exploit the treasures of the New World with an envious eye. His compatriot, Francis Drake, had already fattened Elizabeth's coffers with gold and silver hijacked on the high seas, treasures that the Spanish had, in turn, stripped from the royalty of the Aztecs and the Incas. What Raleigh really needed, he convinced Elizabeth, was a base of operations in the New World. From that base, he could send expeditions inland in search of gold ore. But according to historian Kupperman, Raleigh also had a darker purpose in mind, a kind of sanctioned piracy called privateering.
I think thought he could build a colony on the backs of the Spanish, basically. He chose the location for Roanoke because it was a good location for attempting to prey on the Spanish treasure fleet.
The pursuit of gold on the high seas and inland would come to haunt the Roanoke colony. TLC will return with Archaeology. Return to the battlefield, Sunday at 10 on TLC.
Sun comes standard. The Del Sol from Honda.
This is no ordinary toothbrush. This is the Braun Oral-B Ultra. Clinically proven to remove plaque better than an ordinary toothbrush. Dentists say change your toothbrush every 3 months. We say change it forever. The new Braun Oral-B Ultra.
Welcome to Thomasville, where exceptional craftsmanship and solid values still exist. At our national summer sale, you'll find extraordinary furniture extraordinarily priced. Call your nearest retailer now for more details on fine furniture at a very fine price. The Thomasville National Summer Sale. Be sure not to miss it, because after September 4th, the summer and this sale will be over. Thomasville. Make yourself at home.
Next, on Real History's Sacred Quest Week, against the odds, American experts scour the Turkish wilderness, losing money and credibility fast. A sacred search or a fool's errand? Find out on Quest for the Ark, coming up next on TLC. Tomorrow, on Science Frontiers, witness the complexity of creation, the particulars of procreation, the miracle of life. The mystery of birth, tomorrow night at 10 on TLC.
We now continue with Archaeology on TLC.
Not all of the members of the first colony at Roanoke were soldiers. Some were listed on the rolls as miners, those who would be digging for gold. And Walter Raleigh had also sent what was, in effect, a blue ribbon scientific commission with the expedition. One was the artist and surveyor, John White, soon to become governor of the lost colony. His task was to sketch and paint all of the wonders of the New World. He moved freely among the native Algonquin Indians, recording every aspect of their lives. Scientist Thomas Harriot and metallurgist Joachim Ganz were to analyze the flora, fauna, and minerals to determine just how valuable the New World might be for England. In 1992, Ivor Noel Hume would prove how valuable the soils of Roanoke could still be for archaeology. Almost miraculously, inches below the many levels of previous excavations, he found fragments of ancient glass vials, stoneware flasks, and charred ceramic pots.
This piece of ground doesn't look like much today because it's all backfilled from previous year's excavations. But I am standing on what I take to be the holy grail of Fort Raleigh. And that is the ground on which Messrs. Harriot and Gans actually did their scientific work. This was the place where the English decided America was worthwhile. Right here.
The fragments Hume found could only have come from the laboratory of the Blue Ribbon Science Team. It was the first European science center in the Americas. Mingled with the European glassware and ceramics were shards of Algonquin Indian pots. Previously, such remains had been written off as evidence of Indian habitation at Roanoke before or after the colonists had arrived. For archaeologist David Phelps, they provided clear evidence of the forgotten half of the story of the colony.
The colonists were far more dependent on the Indians than we had previously thought. The reanalysis of the ceramics from the fort area, or what is now called the Science Center, must have indicated a great deal of borrowing on the part of the colonists from the Indian cultures, particularly the ceramics. As you can see, this red pottery, which is really badly burned and oxidized from being in a fire, actually came from the Science Center furnace at Roanoke Island.
The colonists were, almost literally, babes in the woods of Roanoke. If they were to survive, it would be by the goodwill of the Algonquin Indians. But the military majority of the first colony were tragically unsuited to cultivating goodwill. The admiral of the expedition, Raleigh's cousin Richard Grenville, was renowned for his ruthlessness in subjugating Ireland. And the governor of the settlement, Ralph Lane, was a soldier through and through.
The Indians had a very different idea of possessions. They were much more generous with things. If you want to, if I have a bow that you want, you take it. Or if I, your wife has a pot that we like, she'll give it to you. And it was a very democratic, open sort of thing. The English didn't see things like that. They saw possessions as being mine. And so the English gave them beads and mirrors and knives and things like that, and the Indians then proceeded to help themselves occasionally to things that they thought they'd like. And one of the things was a silver cup. And when the English found the silver cup had been missing and that some Indian had taken it, Grenville told Lane, get it back no matter what. And so Lane then proceeded to burn the Indian village and destroy their field to get this wretched cup back. And I always believe that that is the beginning of the bad relations with the Native Americans that exist to some degree to this day. It all begins with this silver cup.
The situation quickly went from bad to worse as winter descended upon Roanoke Island. The Indians began to fall prey to European diseases to which they had no resistance. And feeding the colonists put an intolerable pressure on their own food supply. Lane led an expedition further into the mainland to find gold and managed only to alienate the tribes along the Chowan River. By spring, the English soldiers were short of food and believed that the Indians were plotting against them. Ralph Lane decided to strike first. He called for a meeting with the local tribe. Then had his men open fire on the Indians.
At Christ!
Now be our men.
Victory!
Wingina, their chief, was beheaded. Sh- Shortly after the attack, Francis Drake's fleet stopped at Roanoke to bring supplies. Instead, the soldiers begged passage back to England. TLC will return with Archaeology.
We're out of here.
No, please keep your hands in the cart. We'll come back for that later.
That one needs batteries.
You're going to get Daddy in trouble.
Excuse me? No, that one definitely has too many parts.
We got to go.
The impossible is now possible. Latex enamel in a spray. Introducing Krylon Living Color. The ease of a spray with low odor and the beautiful finish of enamel. New Krylon Living Color. The next revolution in painting.
It was just one of those nights. Just one of those fabulous flights. A trip to the moon on gossamer wings. Just one of those things. If we thought a bit of the
There's an emerging new style of wine, when we Gossamer Bay.
Mighty Mite, America's versatile vac, does things big vacs won't. Lightweight, power for carpets, bare floors, car, workshop. Now, price to move. Mighty Mite.